Bible reading is from John chapter 20, verse 1 to 10. John chapter 20, from verses 1 to 10. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple, and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter, and came to the tomb first. And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying there, yet he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen clothes lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who came to the tomb first, went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. Praise be to God, our risen Savior.
You all a blessed Easter. And on behalf of my wife, I also join with her in wishing you all a meaningful and a blessed Easter. And thank you so much for all your prayers, encouragements, and support. And may the Lord continue to bless us all as we celebrate this time, the resurrection of our Savior. I just want to, you know, the early church, we all know that. The early church, and the church of the first century, they always greeted one another. When somebody said, "He is risen," what they would say? "He is risen indeed." That's what I want from you all. I'm going to say, "He is risen," and you're going to respond by saying, "He is risen indeed." He is risen. You can do better than that. Jesus is risen. Jesus has risen. Yes, He is indeed has risen. That was the response the first visitors to the tomb had received. "He is not here. He is indeed risen." Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you once again for this day wherein we remind ourselves and celebrate the risen Savior, the day in which He was raised from the dead. And we thank you, dear Lord, for your power that has been demonstrated because of your love towards us. Lord, even as we continue to celebrate you and as we continue to meditate your word, Father God, we pray that you will continue to speak to me and speak through me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Rock and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Luke chapter 24, verse 5 and 6. It reads, "In their fright, the woman bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men, the angels, said to them, 'Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? He is not here. He has risen. When the first visitors, the ladies, went to the tomb to embalm the body of Jesus Christ, they saw the stone that covered and was sealed was indeed rolled away. And then they looked into the tomb and there was no body lying. The body of Jesus was not there. They looked into the tomb. That started the very many responses of the people who from then on visited the tomb. It was followed by Mary Magdalene. It was followed by Peter and John. And everyone had the same response, it seems. But it was done. Everybody looked into the tomb, but it was not the same look that everyone had. When you look at the four Gospels, that's what it reminds us. First of all, here we see Mary Magdalene. Probably, you know, she was with the other woman. They were the first ones to come, as we read in Matthew. First ones to come and look at the tomb. They came to embalm the body of Jesus Christ. But then what they saw was something different. They were expecting that the big stone would still be there because it was steel. It was sealed. And then these women folks, they were talking to each other, who will roll the stone for us? And with that thought and talk, they were approaching the tomb, and to their amazement, what they saw was the stone that was rolled away. They saw inside the tomb, the body of Jesus was not there. They returned back, as we read in Matthew's narrative. They returned back to tell what they to tell the disciples what they had experienced. Probably as they were halfway through, Mary Magdalene once again wanted to double check. That's what the gospel writer Luke, Dr. Luke writes. Mary Magdalene alone came to the tomb second time just to double check. And this time, you know, the narrative says she in fact went, and then there was the response from the angels. The two angels who were dressed in robe. That was an awesome experience for her. A wonderful experience for her. And they said, why are you still searching the living among the dead? Jesus, he is not here. He has risen. He has already risen. Go tell the disciples. And when Mary Magdalene came, you know, here we read, she looked into the tomb. She looked into the tomb. Initially, in Matthew's narrative, the woman folk came and saw the big stone was rolled away. Here comes Mary Magdalene and looked into the tomb and saw the two men in white robes, the angels. There was a difference. Looking and seeing. That was the response of the visitors to the tomb on that first resurrection day. Seeing is different and looking is different. You know, when I first went and saw Julie, my wife, the first day I just saw her and I said, yeah, she's the one. But then when I came back home, my parents, in fact, didn't just see her, but they looked at her. Looked at her hair, looked at her height, looked at her legs, whether they are okay, looked at this and that. You know, they said, yeah, they were talking, they were discussing. I realized I never looked into all that. I just saw her. And I fell for her. I liked her. There is a difference, friends. Seeing and looking. The first time visitors, that was the response. And in fact, you know, the Bible says, you know, it was amazing to her. It was something wonderful. She was in awe and wonder. For Mary Magdalene, resurrection was not a wonderful experience, which it's supposed to be, but rather, initially, it was only a wonder, an awe. She was awestruck because of that things that she saw. The big stone rolled away, the seals were gone, white men in robe, dazzling white, and there comes the response. He is not here. All this, you know, she was overwhelmed. Of course, she was awestruck in wonder. But it was not a wonderful experience as it was supposed to be. Many a times, even though the resurrection days, the Easters have come and gone, you know, many people are in the same situation and condition. Many a times they, you know, think about Easter. They are still in awe and wonder. What is it? I don't understand. How can it be? And somebody would come and say, oh, it is just, you know, transmigration of souls. You know, when a person dies, you know, that person's soul migrates into another person. And the person would say, oh, okay, that's what the resurrection is. No, that's not what the Bible says. And somebody would come and say, you know what? Resurrection is nothing but, you know, being, you know, rebirthed many, many times. When you die, you are actually reborn into something. Maybe an ant, or a donkey, or a dog, or maybe a person of an higher level. Oh, that is what resurrection is. Friends, it's something wonderful. The person cannot understand, and the person is confused. Resurrection, according to the Bible, is not something that you become after you die. Or it is not you become part of something else. Your soul transmigrates into somebody else's soul. That's not what the Bible says about resurrection. It is taking the immortality. That is living after death, yes. But it is not living after death by nullifying yourself or losing your identity. Bible talks about bodily resurrection. That is what has happened to Jesus Christ. He was resurrected. He has risen with a glorified body, with a resurrected body, all the same, with a spiritual body, all the same, with a heavenly body that is suited to heaven, all the same. Jesus has risen. Jesus has risen from the dead with a glorified body. And for a person who still thinks that resurrection is something that I can't understand, it is something that wonder, that I am awestruck by that concept, and it is something wonder, that person is called a seeker. The person is still seeking after truth. Many a times, people stay in that level. I don't know, as you are seated, you are still a seeker, or still in that level of thinking that resurrection is something that your soul migrates into another person's soul. Or you're being, born, reborn many a times. That is not what the resurrection that the Bible talks about. That is not the resurrection that Jesus Christ had. When the angel said, "He has risen," it was a bodily resurrection. With a glorified body, with a resurrected body, Jesus has risen from the dead. And when you turn to the John's narrative, John chapter 20, that is where we see another person. That was the lesson that was read to us this morning. There we see John and Peter. They were given the news that Jesus has resurrection, has risen from the dead. And in fact, what was told to them was, Jesus' body is not there. Somebody has stolen it. Somebody has taken it. On hearing that, if you read John chapter 20, Mary Magdalene, verse 2. So Mary Magdalene came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, his name is John, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciples, that is John, started for the tomb. They started running. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter, because he was younger than Peter. So John outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Then look at the verse. It says, verse 5, John bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. John came to the tomb first, bent over and looked at the strips of the linen lying, but did not go in. He just looked at it. But he did not go in. Same idea. Even in the original writings of the gospel, there is a different word that has been used. Here it is just having a passing look. He looked at it. He was a little bit afraid or concerned. He just looked at it. A passing look. He was also a person who was so eager. He got to know whether Jesus' body is there or not. That's why he ran. He outran. He came to the tomb. But then, even though he was full of eagerness, he had the interest, but then he just looked. He just looked and saw just the linens. Just the linens. Sometimes, you know, people are, especially in relationship to Jesus Christ, they have a lot of eagerness. Lot of eagerness to know the truth and, you know, to walk with Jesus Christ and all that. But then they have the eagerness, but they don't have the drive. I don't know where you fit in. But even that is not enough. Again, when you read further down, there is another experience that we see. Then comes Peter. Let's read on. Verse 6. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Here comes Peter. Peter comes and then he straight goes in into the tomb. No fear. He goes in and looks at the linen. And looks at the linen, they are separate. The linen that covered the head on the side of the head. And the other linen on the side. It looked as if, you know, somebody has taken it and folded and kept it as it is. So these details Peter could see. He went in and saw. That is where the analysis comes. Or, you know, not only the interest level, but going to the next step of finding and analyzing or diagnosing the truth. You know, many a times in the history, even now, our contemporary, there is a person called Lee Strobel. He has written a lot of books, research books. He once was, not an anchor, but he was one of the Chicago TV, you know, news reporter. Well-paid, well-respected person. He's also a lawyer. He wanted to disprove that Jesus Christ has not risen from the dead. He was not a Christian. And for that, you know, he took a sabbatical and went in search of the truth and wanted to disprove. And he went to, you know, met with all the, you know, theologians and other pastors and to the places where Jesus was, crucified and he was buried. All this research he did, read extensively. And then by the time, you know, he wanted to write and he wanted to, after analyzing everything, dissecting everything, you know, detailing everything, looking through everything through the microscope, every minute detail of the fact of resurrection, finally, you know what happened? He became a Christian. He became a believer in the Lord. Instead of repudiating resurrection, he started writing that resurrection is true. Same case with Jonathan Edward. You know, he was a lawyer who wanted to disprove that Jesus did not rise from the dead. But by the time he finished his research, he ended up as a believer. And later on, he became a famous preacher. God has used him to bring in a revival in the church in his times. And C.S. Lewis of Cambridge, a prominent professor, English professor, an atheist, he wanted to disprove that Jesus did not exist. But look at him, when you enter into any bookstore, you know, you can't but find C.S. Lewis's books. I can add more examples. You know, if you, it's not enough that you stay in awestruck and wonder level. Maybe in your lifetime that you prayed at a time of need and God answered and healed you and maybe provided you and blessed you. And many a times it is an experience, an emotional experience that has come and gone just like a soda bottle, you know. That's it. And only when at times of need you run to Jesus. It's only an awestruck experience for you. It does not become the resurrection, and the relationship with Jesus Christ has not become a real relationship, a wonderful experience in your life. You are still a seeker, but God wants you to grow out of it and to not only be a person who can, you know, full of eagerness, but also a person who can analyze. The Bible says faith is not only a gift from God, and faith comes by questioning. Take the Bible and read through it. As you read and analyze, because it is the word of God, and it will not return back without fulfilling its purposes. It will change you. And it will change you for the better. And it will change you for a better relationship with Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. Finally, when you read further down, we see another person looking at the tomb. Same John. After Peter had come inside and analyzed all these, the Bible says, look at verse 8 again. Finally, the other disciple, that is John, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. This is a different word in the original text. He saw and believed. This time, it was not the first time experience that he went and just looked, peeped into the tomb and looked, but rather, this time, you know, second time, after Peter analyzed everything, you know, he went and saw. The night bulb moment happened. He believed. He believed. He trusted. He trusted. Yes, Jesus has risen. Still, they were not able to correlate what the scripture was saying, but he believed. Friends, that is the highest experience of belief that God expects us. You know, resurrection is a fact. Resurrection is a fact. It's an historical fact. It's a bodily resurrection. And Jesus has indeed risen. And the Bible says he has shown to many, all of his disciples. And Paul says he appeared to me. And also to 500 disciples. And for 40 days plus. You know, he stayed. He stayed with the disciples after the resurrection. He taught them. He trained them. He equipped them. It is a fact. He still lives today. He is the same yesterday, today, and for tomorrow. Nobody can, even the death cannot, you know, confide him or put him down. He has risen from the dead. And resurrection has to do with faith. It's a fact, and it calls for your faith and my faith. It should not just stay in the level of wonder, or in the level of just eagerness, or in the level of intellectual analysis. But rather, it should seep down to the heart wherein we believe. That is what is called for from each and every one of us. Why? Because, you know, it can only be experienced now. Resurrection can be experienced now. We cannot, you know, just like Thomas did, we cannot go and touch Jesus' wounds. We do not have the, you know, privilege of, you know, walking with Jesus Christ, just like the disciples did. But now, we have the privilege, and it is called upon from each and every one of us, to believe, and also to experience. Experience the power, because resurrection has to do with power. First of all, it says, you know, resurrection is God's power. It's a demonstration of God's power. You know, if you have your Bibles with you, let's read. You know, please turn to Romans chapter 6. Have that chapter open. Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. That's where we read. Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. It says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, why? Just as Christ was raised from the dead, how? Through the glory of the Father. Through the power of the Father. By the majesty of the Father. By the incredible power that can only be ascribed to the Father. He was raised by God's power. It is the demonstration of God's power. You know, elsewhere we read, you know, God has demonstrated his love by sending his son to the cross because he loved us so much. But in the resurrection, God has demonstrated his power. Nobody can. You know, he alone can bring something out of nothing. He alone can, you know, bring out a big army from the valley of dry bones. And he alone can, you know, what is dead and gone, bring back to life. Because he is life. He is the source of life. And Jesus himself has claimed that I am the resurrection and the life. Friends, as we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday, you know, let's be reminded that as you have placed your view, if you place your faith in Jesus Christ, or if you have placed your faith in Jesus Christ, you know, it is the demonstration of God's power in my life, in your life. Because God alone can and God can. Because God alone can and God can. I don't know, as you are seated here, you know, last 2 weeks, you know, was a time wherein in one of my, you know, life's, you know, situations, it was something, you know, beyond hopelessness. It was dead and gone. But then I stand here this morning to testify to the fact that the resurrected power of Jesus Christ, which has been poured, you know, through the Holy Spirit out of his love, you know, has demonstrated his power. God can and God alone. That is what is expected of you and I. Friends, resurrection calls for the faith. It's a fact, but it calls for the faith. A simple faith, which alone can please us God. It is called for. And when you have, and when you open the door of faith, you see God's power. It's not only the resurrection is the demonstration of God's power, as you continue to read, it is to recognize that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Why he was resurrected? Yeah, he was God. Death cannot hold him. But then the Bible also says in Romans chapter 1 and verse 4, you know, God has raised so that he can recognize Jesus Christ. It's not that, you know, before the death and resurrection, he was not the Son of Jesus, the Son of God. But rather, after the resurrection, God has double stamped, acknowledged and recognized and glorified you and said, he is indeed the Son of God. That's what resurrection is. He is exalted, the one in whom you and I have placed our faith. Jesus Christ is the exalted one. It's not only the resurrection reminds us that God's power has been demonstrated, but it also reminds us that God is exalted. And one day, the day is going to come that every knee is going to bow and proclaim and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. It's not only demonstration of God's power. It's not only, demonstration that Jesus Christ is the exalted and the glorified one. There is none other equal to him. Also, it is your experience. It is your experience. As you read Romans chapter 6, verses 5 to 10, because Christ resurrected, you know for sure that you are united with Christ. That's what the verse says. For if you have been united with him in the death like this, we will certainly also be united with him in resurrection like this. It's because of his resurrection, we are united with him. And he is the first fruit. And we will be with him for the eternity to come. When? Not when you just stay as a awestruck person. Not just when you stay as a person with eagerness. Not just a person when you stay as a person who just analyzes about Jesus Christ. But rather, when you place your faith in Jesus Christ, friends, the privilege is you're going to be united. You're going to be united with Jesus Christ for the eternity to come. And then the verse goes on to say, it's not only the union with Christ, but also verse 6 says, for we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because of that resurrection, you're not only united with Jesus Christ, but also the power of sin has no mastery over you. You are not slave to sin. God gives you that power. And then, as you further down read here, verse 8, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. There is a new life that comes. And the list goes on and on. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's not only you know God's power, but rather you have the privilege of being united with him. Being dead to your sin, because your sin has been buried with him. And when you're resurrected, the sin has no power over you. And then it gives you the hope. And that's why Paul prays, I want to know Christ, especially the power of his resurrection. I want to know Christ, especially the power of his resurrection. That should be our prayer. That should be our wish. Day in and day out, I want to know Christ. And in and through that, I want to know the power of the resurrection, wherein I can have the mastery over sin, where I can continually abide by in Christ, where I will continually hope for the new life that is budding in me as he is conforming me into the image of Jesus Christ. And above all, every step of my way, thank God, I can march victoriously and say, because the powerful one, the life-giving one, is with me. Who can bring nothing, everything out of nothing? The one who can roll away the stone that covered the tomb. The one who brought the person who was dead and gone for 4 days. And he is the same one who has raised Jesus Christ in order to exalt him And the same power is available to me. I am not succumbed to sin. I will not let myself to be subjected to whatever that controls me. Whatever that tries to annihilate me or to deplete my energy. I will continue to live with Christ because the power is with me. I want to know Christ and the resurrection power in and through knowing Him. That is what resurrection actually means. It is not just a historical fact that stays. It is not an awestruck wonder that you once in a while come and say hi and bye. It is not an intellectual, discipline that you go and analyze and leave it and collect the data. But rather, it has to do with your life. The life that begins with faith. Faith in that simple fact that God has power. And God has raised Jesus Christ from the dead. God alone can. And the same demonstration of God's power is available to me. Because I have the hope that I'm going to be with Him. I have the hope I'll be united to Him on a daily basis. I have the hope that I'll be a new man on a daily basis. And that's why I pray that I want to know Christ. I want to live for Christ. I want to build a relationship with Christ. If that could be our desire, if that could be our prayer, that is what the meaningful celebration of Easter. If not, it is just like the soda bottle. You can just come and go, make noise or heat the seat and go. But God wants little more than that. To have faith in God and His power. And to experience Jesus Christ so that you can have the same power in your life. Soon after the worship service, we are going to have, after the lunch, we are going to have the baptism service. That is a meaningful experience. That the 7 children are going to depict. Because as they go under the water, they are going to say, I am dead to my sin. And I am raised with Christ as they come out of the water. How did that happen? Because in the Bible, in the Bible, we also have a verse which says, they believed in their heart and they are going to confess in their mouth that Jesus Christ is their Savior and Lord. And that they are going to demonstrate the inner grace that I've experienced as they are going to go down into the water and come out of the water. Friends, that's a different experience. If you have not experienced that, even today is a good day. Just to come and say, Jesus, I give my life to you. I trust in you. I'm not worried about the details, and I'll know about them later, but I just want to trust in you. If that could be your prayer, after the worship service, we will be available, me and Pastor Sunil. If you want to come and pray with us. Or if you have any other concerns, let's mutually encourage and pray for each other. Come after the service. We'll be here. And the prayer team members of our prayer team, we'll be here. Let's come and let's pray for each other and encourage one another. Also, please stay for the baptism service. And we are going to have the baptism. There are 3 more, who are willing to take baptism. So we'll be having one scheduled in the next 1 or 2 months. So if you want to, attend the baptism classes, we'll have it. So if you want to take baptism, and if you want to, you need to attend the baptism classes, please see me and we will schedule, and in another two months, we are going to have another baptism service. Praise God for that. So for now, you know, once again, I wish you all a blessed Easter, and may the resurrection power be available through Jesus Christ, because it has been poured into your life, because God has loved you. And thank you once again for attending this service, and God be with you, and God bless you. And now we will go around the Lord's table. You know, the Lord's